Is the World Health Organization hiding China's role in the coronavirus pandemic? And will that communist nation ever be held accountable for the deaths of millions worldwide, including more than 550,000 here in the United States? Good evening. I'm Guy Benson, in for Kennedy this week. Earlier today, the WHO released their much-anticipated report on the origins of the virus. And once again, it seems to parrot the Chinese Communist Party's claim that they did nothing wrong. According to the report, it is, quote, extremely unlikely the virus escaped a lab. And it claims COVID most likely jumped from humans, or to humans, I should say, at a wild animal farm. But the United States has now joined a dozen other countries slamming the report and China's lack of transparency. Let's get right to it with the panel. Attorney and Republican strategist Alexandra Wilkes is here. Reason senior editor and author of Panic Attack, Robbie Suave. And radio host, Democratic strategist, and Fox News contributor, Leslie Marshall. Hello, everyone. Welcome.
Hi, Guy.
Hi, Guy.
Hello.
Robbie, why should anyone treat this piece of CCP propaganda as anything other than a total joke?
They shouldn't. It is a total joke. You're exactly right. This question needs serious study, not the kind of study that the entirely in the pocket of China WHO is going to give it. Not the kind of attention the communist totalitarian government of China is going to give it. We don't know for sure that coronavirus came from a lab. It's just a theory. But it is a theory with some evidence, and there are many experts who think it's more than just a theory, and the subject deserves serious consideration, and we should absolutely not believe what we're hearing from the World Health Organization authorities.
Alex, I watched this, and I actually wonder, is this report worse than having no report at all?
I mean, basically, because even the report itself admits that it's missing significant amounts of data to make conclusions. It contradicts our own State Department cables, information we've known for almost a year now. So look, I think that it's a real sham. And unfortunately, I think that the Biden administration has been playing right into the Chinese's hands. I mean, when you have the Biden administration rejoin the WHO with absolutely no consequences, it signals to the Chinese, in addition to our horrible performance in Alaska a few weeks ago, it signals to the Chinese that we can be taken advantage of, that they're the superior power to us. And in fact, they do need to pay for what happened a year ago.
Leslie, I think it's actually rather telling because WHO has become these sort of lapdog lackeys of communist China. It's been very disturbing to see. But even their leader, who was handpicked by Beijing, said today that the investigation on the lab leak theory was not, quote, extensive enough. When even he's saying that, it's kind of a red flag, no pun intended.
Ha ha. Look, it doesn't matter whether it's Biden, Trump, Democrat, or Republican. China's going to lie. China is going to try and prevent our government and, quite frankly, any government except for their own, even if it's a communist government, from finding information they don't want to find. Look, top epidemiologists, I always trip on that word, throughout the world have said you really are going to have that animal host to human host connection. That's really what we see in most viruses. And that's probably why they, you know, the general consensus, even though there are some that disagree and think it came from a lab, that it didn't come from a lab. But the bottom line is,
but it could have, right?
But Leslie, is better than
it could have, right? I mean, we don't.
It could have, but it's highly. It could have, but it's highly unlikely. The overwhelming majority of healthcare professionals, scientists. It's not just what China says. It's what the overwhelming majority of healthcare professionals and scientists worldwide believe. But of course, this report is not complete. And so I don't think no report is better than a report, but I think the report should have waited until they can, at some point, try and get a more complete investigation to get more information to the general public.
I mean, I think putting out a sham is worse than putting out nothing at all. That's my opinion. Meanwhile, the White House is working with private companies, sort of a related topic, to develop COVID vaccine passports. That's to spark some criticism among GOP lawmakers. They say it's invasive, hypocritical. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis has vowed to take executive action on this down in Florida. So is this just a political move by the Biden White House, or are these passports really the only way to fast track a return to normal life? Alex, are you a yes, a no, or a maybe on vaccine passports? Is there some middle ground here?
I am a no with an asterisk. So, I mean, what I see here is, number one, that this is a part of the Biden administration's larger goal of remaking the country in a progressive image using the coronavirus pandemic as cover. And I think that, secondly, you know, you're running into huge issues of medical privacy and legitimate concerns about to whom we are handing over all of this data. And I do think that that's going to present a problem. I think it's going to be one of the biggest debates of our time coming up. And it has the potential to really create two Americas here, one for those who have been vaccinated and those who have not. I also think it's completely counterproductive to encouraging people to get the vaccine, which I believe is safe and effective.
So, Robbie, let's talk about this. I'm of mixed mind a little bit because, look, to get into this building at Fox today, I had to take this little survey about my potential symptoms or lack thereof and then get a little green emblem on an app and then show it when I walked in the door. That was the barrier to entry. I had to do it, right? If that's going to be going to a Yankees game or going to a concert or whatever, is it necessarily a bad thing to speed the return to normalcy with something like this if maybe there's an expiration date and certainly if the government isn't overly involved in it?
Right, and the government being involved is key. So I'm totally opposed to any effort by the government to require vaccine passports or anything of the sort. In general, I'm against all the efforts the government is undertaking, from lockdowns to masks to social distancing. Now, if private entities want to do that, you can agree or disagree, and you can not frequent those establishments if you don't agree with it. That's honestly fine by me. That should devolve to the individual owner of a business or a sports stadium or a concert venue or whatever, and we can kind of let the market decide, right? I think that's fine. I will fight and oppose any effort by the government to require such a thing, and that is where conservatives' ire should be concentrated, not on preventing any of them from existing anywhere. There's this new tendency that everything has to either be banned or mandated. Mm-hmm. And there is some middle ground for individual private entities to decide that for themselves.
Leslie, where do you come down on this? Because, look, I'm nervous about the data privacy stuff. Is there some registry of people somewhere? How is the government involved or not involved? If there's an expiration or a sunset date, will people actually abide by it? Will the goalposts get moved and moved like we've seen over the course of a year? I think there are fair criticisms here. What do you think?
Well, first of all, the federal government isn't doing this. This was actually something that the private sector want. More than half of business owners, small and large, really want this. And one business that wants this are the airlines.
Sure.
And look, to get into this country, I adopted my son in 2007 from Pakistan, had to have a number of vaccines before he could be given a visa and then apply for U.S. citizenship as my son, a baby of a woman and a man, my husband, who are Americans, too. I'm going to the Bahamas Friday. Oh. We had to take a COVID test in addition to that. When we get off the plane, we will have our temperature taken. We will have to have a COVID test on day 5 and then 3 days before returning to the United States. Additionally, to go to other countries, you need, for some countries, a malaria vaccine, a yellow fever vaccine, a tuberculosis vaccine. So the bottom line here is this is nothing new, and we as consumers have a right not to travel to those countries, and Florida has a right, but they're going to hurt themselves with tourism possibly because the airlines are probably going to mandate this. It will come down to private businesses.
Leslie.
The government is going to help those businesses, but this is not Joe Biden doing this. Sorry, I know you guys like to blame him for a lot, but he can't be blamed for this.
Leslie, I have to confess, I didn't hear a word you said after the Bahamas, and my mind just floated away. Please take me with you. Is that okay? I'll have a passport. I'll do whatever you need. A tattoo. I actually don't have the vaccine yet. I want it desperately. All right, the panel returns a little bit later. School may be back in session in California, but not for Californians. Fox News exclusive reveals that while San Diego public school teachers are cutting class and forcing their regular students to learn on Zoom, some of them are volunteering to appear in person to teach detained child migrants during spring break. So in case we needed another reason to despise California teachers unions, we've got another reason. When will the politics and the dishonesty end and actually caring for kids resume? The panel is back. Alexandra Wilkes, Robbie Suave, and Leslie Marshall. Leslie, come on. Really?
You want facts? San Diego County does not include all of the city of San Diego, nor does it include all of the county of San Diego. There are various unified school districts, including the county he just talked about, and that is a lie. You can Google it. You can call the school district, as I did earlier today. Kids in different counties, including San Diego, some schools, three high schools in that county, are open. 50% of the teachers polled in my kids' school here in L.A. County didn't want to send their kids to school. They preferred continuing for Zoom the rest of the year. But throughout San Diego County, there are schools that have opened in March, some are opening April, some May, and some June, depending on their individual school districts.
Leslie,
teachers that have volunteered to teach these children English and some arts to relieve some stress for the children and to help them to assimilate in the classroom because they don't speak English, and that is going to be more difficult not only for that child, the other kids in the class,
Leslie,
and for the
teachers. Leslie, why should a single immigration detention center or what have you, why should a single illegal immigrant get in-person learning before American school children have access to in-person learning?
But they're not. American children aren't being, first of all, so what do you want to do? You want to bring a bunch of computers
Zoom?
Okay. All right. One. Two, the children in many districts are already in school, whether they're in school full-time or part-time. And like I said, some kids
worse
are home
in the country.
On Zoom
One of the worst.
By choice. Some parents just want to finish out the year and start afresh in September. Some of my own friends here in Los Angeles.
Okay, so that could be the choice that some parents make. I think there should be the option for every family to have their kids in school. That's pro-science. That's pro-education, Robbie. And I'm sort of mystified that this is being defended on any level.
There are schools that have been open the entire year for the duration of the pandemic,
yep.
Many of them private schools. They've not had hardly any problem. They have dealt with it with the limited resources they have, with the billions of dollars being pumped into the public school system that has been pumped into the public school system for years, by the way. They can make it work. They're just unwilling. The teachers' unions have been unwilling. They have fought reopening every step of the way. Our children are suffering. Our children are dying. The teen suicide rate has gone up. They need to go back to school. It's been a full year. It is inexcusable that this is going on. Totally,
Alex,
totally unacceptable.
I kind of feel like if you're a moderate out there in Southern California and you're not really sure where you come down on certain issues, stories like this might make you a little bit more, hard line, whether on immigration or school choice or against teachers' unions. I mean, this is the type of thing that could radicalize people in some ways.
It's absolutely an animating issue. And, you started out by asking, when will the politics end here? And what I hope for is that this glaring hypocrisy represents a kind of paradigmatic change we might see, where we see parents step up and actually run for the school board, pay more attention to what's going on in the leadership of these schools, because there is just absolutely no reason why this should be going on. And whether it's this or it's these comments that we come to find out later from teachers complaining that they're not babysitters or complaining about entitled parents, it really seems like the teachers have forgotten to whom they are accountable, and that's taxpayers. So I really hope that these kinds of examples are, a rallying point for parents to step up and to get more involved.
It's got to be for a lot of them. And by the way, 15 points to Alex for using the word paradigmatic. Well done. Panel returns in a bit. Should college athletes get paid like the pros? The NCAA is facing off at the Supreme Court tomorrow in a case that could change everything for college athletics and college athletes who want compensation. Now, they do generate billions of dollars for their sports, and now Supreme Court justices will hear arguments on whether colleges' restrictions on the kind of benefits athletes receive violate antitrust laws. This comes as Republican and Democratic lawmakers are working to make student-athlete compensation a reality under federal law. Is March Madness going to end with a big payday for student athletes? Let's discuss. The panel is back. Alex, Robbie, and Leslie. Robbie, I take a little bit of a different view on this than a lot of conservatives. I see arguments on both sides, but I see this hashtag that some of the students are using, not NCAA property. Okay, they're not, No one's forcing students to go to college, to accept these scholarships, to go play collegiate athletics. They could go and try to go pro, but they don't, in many cases, try to immediately go pro because they see clearly some value beyond the full rides, beyond all the perks of student athletes, to performing at a high level on a big stage in front of a lot of people. I'm just not sure that the victimhood on some elements of this is being sold in a fair way. What do you think?
That's an interesting take, and you and I agree on most things. On this thing, I'm quite sympathetic to a lot of the athletes, except for the very top, most elite, best athletes. A lot of these students do end up getting a raw deal, in my mind, because there's a bit of trickery going on the part of the team, on a part of the college, saying, yeah, you should do this, it'll be great for you, you know, focus on sports, not your athletics, et cetera, and then they kind of end, and then at the end of it, what do they have to show for it, especially if they're not making any money? I'm really sympathetic to the idea, you know, they can't even make money off merchandise depicting them.
Right, which
is,
you know.
Yeah, which I think that doesn't strike me as fair. I'm not sure what the Supreme Court will decide about it. The legal matter is very much a different thing. But I feel for a lot of these kids, and I don't like the way it's handled, even at the college level.
Yeah, I feel like they're using their likeness or their name. That gets a little bit trickier to make the argument. And look, to your other point, this is why I think good athletes should go to good schools and get good educations and try to have the best of both worlds, for example, at Northwestern University. Go Cats. Leslie, what do you make of this? I'm sort of a traditionalist. I love college sports so much. I'm not going to carry water for the NCAA. I know there are problems, but I don't want to see college sports sort of blow up. So that's part of the reason that I'm at least hesitant or have some trepidation here of big, big changes.
Okay, so now I can't take you to the Bahamas because, no offense, I have no interest in sports at all except being from Boston. If the Red Sox are in the World Series, I'll watch, like, the final game. You know, if the Patriots are playing in the Super Bowl, I'll watch. I'm one of those fair-weather fans, sorry.
Actively alienating me in every way.
My son is an athlete, and I have to say that if he went to a university or a college that offered him a scholarship, and some of these kids get cars and things like that, they bust their butt when they are at these schools to be that top athlete. They bring in millions of dollars, including you know, the swag out there that has, you know, their likeness and their name on it. And yeah, they get the card, they get the free education, but the school gets millions. Why shouldn't they get a little piece of that? And why do some of them go to college and not go right to pro? One, that 4 years can help them to be a better athlete.
Sure.
Two, in the NFL, they're a little fish in a big aquarium. At some of these colleges, they're a big fish in a small pond.
That's
and then
value,
lastly,
right.
They get the degree.
Right, that's value. That's in, you know, sort of perks or compensation. Quickly, Alex, your last thought on this.
I think that the goal here is going to be to try to balance out the interests of the players with, I think, what everybody's interest here is in maintaining the collegiate, you know, atmosphere of the games. As you mentioned, nobody wants to see this be a parallel pro sports league. So I think that, quite frankly, the states need to get involved.
I think
some
people
pass their own laws.
I think some people would love to see it become sort of like a minor league. I don't want to see that, but that's sort of the rub here for a lot of people. Now, speaking of getting paid, are you interested in great weather and a hot salary? Well, it may pay to be a lifeguard, especially in Los Angeles County. According to a new report, a number of LA-based lifeguards are raking in huge bucks. 82 lifeguards made more than $200,000 in 2019. Seven of them made more than $300,000. And the top earner pulled in nearly $400,000. And a lot of that's coming at taxpayer expense. So is this all excessive? Is it over the top or is it totally chill? Robbie, first question, very important. Is $392,000, which was the top salary or wage earned by one of these lifeguards in 2019, $392,000, is that more than the actual actors on Baywatch made?
That's what I'm wondering. It sounds like a lot to run on the beach in slow motion. No,
yes.
I'm sure. You know, I don't know. Maybe they saved like a million people from shark attacks. I tend to doubt it. It seems pretty steep, especially because like the highest paid person is probably just like coordinating the schedule for the lifeguards or something. So I have questions. That's all I'm saying.
Alex, are we in the wrong line of work?
I mean, look, Guy, we're from New Jersey here. I mean, that's like the average salary of a municipal employee. So it's not enough to make this Jersey girl blush, but I see why they're concerned.
So, Leslie, I will point out, because I did some of the in the weeds reading on this, out of the top 20 earners of these L.A. lifeguards, only two of them were women. So are you going to put on your red one piece and slow motion run to protest?
Okay. First of all, if I were going to put anything on, it would be whether a one piece or two piece. I got to get my body in post-COVID shape to apply for that job because, you know, I know people think, oh, I make tons of money and I'm married to a doctor, but that's a good salary. I'd have to look into that. But, you know, I have to say they do save lives. As a matter of fact, two of my friends, they lost their son and there's a statue to him. He was saving somebody's life and he drowned saving a person's life. But it is a lot of money when you look at it in comparison to other lifesavers, whether it be teachers or first responders like our police officers and our firefighters. But most of that money, since you were in the weeds, you also know, Guy, is in overtime. And that's something that the various districts could put the kibosh on.
But, Robbie, is this like, is this a year-round thing? I mean, is it seasonal? And you're making $200,000, $300,000, $400,000? That's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds like a pretty good deal, right? Especially if, I don't know, were the beaches even totally open for the last year, right? We had the health authorities trying to scare anyone out of even going into the water for different reasons, although that was terrible guidance because being outside is safe. Being outside is pretty safe. So yeah, please go back to the beaches. Maybe don't tip your lifeguard. That seems unnecessary, given what we just learned.
Well, look, I could just say, if I'm at the beach with the light reflecting off of my incredibly white body, it blinds people. It's a disaster. I could never do this job. I don't really tan properly, so job's not for me, but the salary is pretty impressive. If I'm a taxpayer, I'm probably going to the beach as often as I possibly can to get my money's worth for what we're apparently they're paying those people out there. So congrats, lifeguards. Panel, appreciate it. Alexandra, Robbie, Leslie, fun time tonight.